I'm here with Aidan from Sling at Aero SA 2025. Aidan, tell me about Sling's current market share. How's it doing in the light sport aircraft experimental market?
So specifically in the light sport aircraft market, we are exporting a lot of our aircraft into America. So America probably makes up at least 65% of our total worldwide market share, specifically because they are taking deliveries of a lot of our training aircraft, the Sling 2 and the Sling LSA. We're able to make them IFR capable, so you can do full IFR flight training and everything on our Sling 2s. And they just can't get enough of them. You know, America's a very, very big place. There's a lot of flight schools there that are making use of our aircraft. We've got two flight schools there, the Sling Pilot Academies, that are exclusively training on Slings only. So they've got entire fleets of Sling 2s and TSIs and high wings that are doing training and everything that side. But at the same time, we're also doing a lot of exporting into places like Australia. We've recently been shifting a lot of focus into Africa as well. So places like Namibia and some of the DRC and Botswana, Mozambique, areas like that. Specifically because the TSI and the high wing are very, very versatile and capable aircraft. They don't need a tarred runway to land. You can put it down in a salt pan. You could put it down on a gravel strip, and it's more than happy to do stuff like that. So the market in Africa is slowly but steadily growing as well. And then a lot of Europe as well. So the UK, we've got quite a lot of kit builders in the UK, places like Poland and places like Germany as well, you know, all over the place. So
out of interest, how many of your aircraft that leave your factory are fully assembled versus those that prefer to kit build their aircraft in their own facility?
So there's a lot of different variables that go into whether or not someone decides to have a ready-to-fly aircraft or not. And it also comes down to their government CAA, and the regulations that they have to follow. So places like Australia are able to accept a ready-to-fly aircraft. And if we're shipping an aircraft that is ready to fly over to Australia, then we are able to take the wings off, we'll take the tail off and the propeller off, put it in the shipping container and send it over to them. We have a distributor in Australia that then reassembles the aircraft that side and it's ready to go. And they're able to put the airplane back together in about 2 weeks, because it's literally just putting the wings on, putting the tail on, hanging the prop again, and it's good to go. But then if you look at markets such as America specifically, at the moment, we're not allowed to sell a ready-to-fly aircraft over a certain weight there. So a lot of so our TSIs and our high wings have to be what we call a quick build kit. So they have to follow the FAA's 51% rule for experimental aircraft, where the owner of the aircraft has to be able to prove that they have built 51% of the airplane. Yeah. So at the moment, the only airplanes that we can send over there fully assembled is our LSA trainers. And then when it comes to the larger aircraft, the four-seater TSI and the four-seater high wing, they have to be sent over as the quick build kit. And then we've got build centers in America, in Torrance, that are capable of fully completing the aircraft build for the customers.
How many aircraft are Sling producing in a year?
Unofficial number was 146 aircraft last year. And of those aircraft, I think at least 65 of them were ready to fly aircraft, and then the rest were made up of normal kits and quick build kits. And then, so it works out to, we were sitting at about 17 aircraft a month, but now in light of Trump's tariff, it's dropped down to around about 12 aircraft a month at the moment. Almost every single piece of this airplane is manufactured here on South African soil. The only things that we don't manufacture ourselves are the propellers, the engines, the avionics, and the tires. Every other component of this aeroplane we either source or manufacture here in South Africa. And we are very, very firm believers in upskilling our own staff. So we currently have about 515 employees working in Sling Aircraft and about 16,000 square foot under roof in terms of manufacturing space. And in every single department that we have, whether it be composite, whether it be electronics, whether it be actual mechanical, aluminium manufacturing or anything like that, we have a lot of experience. We have hundreds, if not thousands, of years of combined experience with highly specialized, capable people that are working for us. And we believe in bringing people into the company and upskilling them and trying to retain our staff for as long as possible. So one of the big differences from the original Sling 4 is that the actual cabin space is slightly bigger, and then the wing profile is different as well. So it's a new wing profile. It's designed to be a little bit faster and sleeker than the Sling 4 was, and it's able to carry a little bit more weight. So the max all-up weight of the TSi is higher than the Sling 4.
When I, as a pilot, when I hear faster and sleeker, I hear less stability.
So I would have to disagree with you. So faster and sleeker doesn't always mean less stability, because we didn't shorten the wings or anything like that. The wings are still pretty much the same span as the Sling 4 was. It's just a new aerofoil that we have chosen to use for the wings.
Yeah. Well done. Talk to me about Rotax and this four-bladed prop.
Yeah, so this is the Rotax 916IS. It's 160 horsepower, turbocharged, fuel-injected, intercooled engine. It's fully fader controlled as well, which means that basically you don't have to worry about doing any mixture control or anything like that on the engine. It's all automatically done for you. It simplifies it. The workload for the pilot is way, way, way down. And the amount of sensors that go throughout this engine that run through the FedEx system is incredible. I mean, there's basically not a single thing that this engine does that you will not know about. The way that we've integrated the engine monitoring systems into the Garmin Ethos that we offer, it basically shows, so you can tell what your manifold pressure is doing, what your manifold temperature is doing, oil pressure, oil temperature, fuel pressure, every single one of your individual EGTs, your coolant temperature and pressure. There's nothing that this engine will do that you are not aware of in the cockpit, which I think is a really nice safety feature, because it means that you, as the pilot, have a much better control over everything that's going on. And then for, so this is the Duke four blade flash black propeller. So it's a French company we've recently actually partnered with. So they are actually helping us develop propellers specifically for the Slings. Okay. This variant here is one of their standard four bladed propellers. It is a hydraulically controlled variable pitch propeller. So we've got a pitch lever in the cockpit that allows you to control the pitch of the...
Previous Slings never used to have pitch levers, or they would automatic pitch.
Yeah. So previous Slings would have the Airmaster, which was a constant speed propeller. It was an electronically controlled version. We just found with the Airmaster propeller specifically that we wanted something that was a little bit more simple and reliable. So we moved over to a hydraulically mechanical system, which we feel is also, it's just a little bit safer. It's less things to go wrong. Business decision for the high wing. I think that one of our founders, Mike Blythe, has always had this incredible talent to be able to almost see into the future of aviation. And he's always had this knack for knowing what the market is going to want before, sometimes even before the market itself knows what it's going to want. So I think he was one of the largest influences in making the decision to develop a high wing. And you know, a lot of the design choices that he made or insisted on have proven time and time again, especially like I've seen it myself speaking to some of the customers that I've sold to, where there were some design choices that were made earlier on that we weren't so sure of. And now all of a sudden we're seeing the customers are going, this is incredible. We're so glad that you've made this decision.
Can you give me one or two examples?
Well, there's one big example I can give to you is if you have a look at the Cessna Caravan over there versus our high wing, there's one big component that our high wing is missing that the Caravan has.
It's that wing spar.
Exactly. So we've gone with a strutless wing design, same as the Cessna 210. And the biggest advantage to not having a strut there, there's two main advantages. The first advantage is that your visibility from inside the cockpit is completely uninterrupted. So the nicest thing with the high wing is you can walk over to it, open it, and jump straight in, because there's nothing, your ingress and egress for the cockpit is really easy. It's effortless. You can walk over, 1 foot there, and I'm in the plane. And now I can just swing my legs in, and it's as easy as that. And then getting out of the aeroplane is just as simple.
Now in the cockpit, Aidan, can you explain to me the new Garmin suite?
So the suite that you see in front of you now comes as the basic package for all of our, for the Sling TSi and the Sling High Wing. And then also in our Sling 2s, we offer the same standard package as well. This is the Garmin G3X suite. So basically it comes with the Garmin GDU 460 10.6 inch touchscreen, which is this large display screen in front of you. It is probably one of the most capable EFA systems I have ever flown with. It's able to do full GPS navigation, flight charts, ADS-B in and out. It has all of your critical flight information displayed in front of you. So it's basically your all-day six-pack steam gauges, but all on a nice fancy touchscreen for you. So this is the Garmin G5. So the way that we basically work it, with an electronic EFIS, you need to have some kind of redundancy built into it. There's your traffic coming into land now on the runway, just so you can see. So that's the ADS-B. Yes. Yeah, that's the ADS-B working.
Great feature.
Yeah, very, very nice safety feature to have because you can see everybody that's around you when you're in the air. So your Garmin G5 displays all of your critical flight information so that if the main screen, for whatever reason, does die, your Garmin G5 has got its own backup battery and it's got an extra 45 minutes of power.
That's great. Sling has done some great work in terms of getting a good suite of avionics in here to make it a much safer aircraft to fly.
So safety is, to us, of paramount importance.
Well done, guys.
Thank you.
Sling's a great story and we're looking forward to seeing more of its growth.